Extraordinary People. Proudly sponsored by Amazing Space Loft Conversions. Creating a better space for extraordinary living.
My guest is a writer and columnist known for her provocative comments, some of which resulted in legal action. Her career as a writer started at the age of 17, and for the last 40-odd years she has written for numerous newspapers and publications and is also the author of some 20 books. She is a self-declared militant feminist and a Zionist. Her hobbies include spite, luncheon and modern Hebrew. She is the one and only Julie Burchill. Welcome, Julie.
Thank you for having me.
You know, when I say the one and only, I actually mean it. Not necessarily even as a compliment, but it is true. There is one of you.
Yeah.
And perhaps in order to find out why, and to go through your extraordinary career in life, we must go back. We must go back to the beginning of your career. And I know that's been documented and you've talked about it a lot, but to put things in context, I think it's important to find out what happened at the age of 17 when you moved from Bristol to London to work for the enemy. Do you want to tell me about it?
Okay. Well, of course, I'm an only child. Of course, I would have to be with my monstrous level of self-fascination. And I came from a very poor, honest background. Both my parents were factory workers. But from a very young age, I wasn't happy with where I came from. And most people who have an impulse to get away have some sob story. They were treated badly, their parents were mean to them, they were unpopular. I was in a strange position of having great parents, being popular, and not wanting any of it. I wanted to be an outsider. Most people who are outsiders want to be accepted. I was accepted, but wanted to be unacceptable. And this is the impulse that has driven me through much of my life.
So you actually wanted to be an outsider and move out more than you wanted to be a writer for the enemy.
It's hard to know what came first. I can't remember. I always thought of writers as being outsiders, so I think they went very well together.
Okay, so then you saw this advert advertising for a writer for the New Musical Express.
New Musical Express was huge at the time. It's hard to think about it now, but it had massive influence. I've got friends who came from New Zealand and Australia who would wait 2 weeks for a copy to arrive and say it was their whole world. It was massively influential, and yes, for me it was a conduit out of my very normal provincial girlhood into this world where people behave really badly, took drugs, had sex, all that sort of thing that I want to do from, like, you know, the age of 13. And so when I saw the advert for a new writer, I was just going back to do my A-levels and I was not liking it one bit. And I answered it, the advert. I did a very manipulative thing. Even though I had a typewriter, I tore some pages out of my school books. And I wrote it by hand, and then I thought it didn't look amateurish enough, so I shook my fountain pen over it to put some blots on it and made it look very schoolgirlish.
And that's how you sent it to them?
Oh, yeah.
And then you were asked to come and stayed?
Yeah, there was only one job, but they liked me so much that they created two jobs, so it was me and my first husband got these jobs. Yeah.
Right. And between you, is it true that you've actually become... You became so influential that you either made or broke bands? Was it that powerful?
I think my first husband was very influential.
Tony Parsons.
I was much less proactive. And once I was sent to interview someone, he was an old hippie, and I actually put some amphetamine sulfate in his tea because I knew it made people talk and I didn't like asking questions. His name was Country Joe McDonald.
Right.
And then his publicity person saw me doing it. And reported me to the headmaster, reported me to my editor, and my editor told me I was very bad and I wouldn't be allowed to go and interview bands anymore, which suited me because I did not want to do it. So I was just kept in the office reading through the foreign newspapers and writing up funny little funny little pieces which suited me because it enabled me to work on my style as opposed to grunting at monosyllabic pop stars, right, which I did not want to do in the first place.
But it's interesting that you said nearly reported you to the headmaster. You were so young, mm-hmm, and you had so much power and so much influence. As you say, people all over the world waited to read the articles to really basically find out who to follow, and that's way before internet and...
Yeah. Yes, it was a brilliant time to be young. I don't envy people, young people going into journalism today. You've got to be rich or your parents have to be in the business. We were so badly paid when we joined the enemy that we had to collect bottles, glass bottles, and take them back. There was a thing called music paper malnutrition, which meant that the wages were so low that nobody, you could either afford to eat or to take drugs, and of course we all chose to take drugs, so we didn't need to eat. But it was such a brilliant, amazing time, and I feel sorry for young people going into journalism now because it's so difficult.
So it is so difficult, and it is a different time, but would you have any advice for a young woman with the talent at 17 now who is desperate to become a journalist? Could you reflect from your experience somehow?
It sounds facile and a bit glib, but I would say don't write about what you know. How I became successful was to pretend to be a person who I eventually grew into. If you only write about what you know, you're going to be boring. I pretended to be this whole other person, and they say fame is a mask that eats the face, and eventually I became the person, the monstrous person I pretended to be.
Do you think so?
Yeah, I know it.
That was the rise of punk, and you often say that you actually weren't even that interested in punk at all. And I have this image of you, which you told me in the past that you would come home and dance to the Isley Brothers rather than listen to.
I was repelled by punk. My attitude to it was very much like your parents are meant to be. It's not music; it's just a racket. That's what I thought to myself. But I knew, because I was a crafty kid, that the enemy was looking for someone to wet nurse them through punk, because none of them understood it. So I pretended to understand it, and I dressed like one, and I acted like one, but I never was one, and all I ever liked was black music.
And you are a very honest person. I mean, you're too honest at times, so there is this contradiction.
I knew it was my only chance to become a writer. When you are from a working class background, you don't sit back and consider your options. You see a chance come towards you and you grab it. And I knew I'd only have to lie for a little bit. Also, don't forget, when I went to the enemy, I also pretended to be Jewish. So I was telling two lies for the price of one. I thought I might as well get them all over with at once.
And then the 70s finished and punk finished and the 80s came and the world became quite different. No, you not just based on your talent, but now it was very much based on perhaps the people you mingled with, and you were a regular at the Groucho.
The 80s were much more to my taste. Now at last I could be myself. So I went to the Face magazine, which Nick Logan, who said I'd given him a nervous breakdown by my antics at the NMB. He was very, very nice to take me on, this considering that he'd been quite nervous because of me. And at the Face, suddenly it was a big showcase to Fleet Street. Suddenly Fleet Street was looking at these style magazines and wanting to pick young writers from them. I was lucky enough to be picked up by the Sunday Times when I was 24. And from then, I guess I've been employed and sacked by every paper in Fleet Street. And then, sort of 10 years ago, when I left sacked from The Independent, I thought I would never get another column again. And I was quite resigned to that because I've got a very happy life anyway. But now I'm a Telegraph. Now I'm a columnist for the Sunday Telegraph. It feels like my whole career started over again. Really excited about it.
So employed and sacked. Sacked because you have a habit of getting into trouble.
Yeah.
And saying things that offend people, or write things that offend people, and getting into fights. Do you actually look for that? Do you enjoy it? Be honest.
Yes.
You do.
I do like to get into trouble.
Why?
I don't know. I think I'm a thrill seeker. And I think I was born scrappy. I'm not... When you're a person like me, especially with women, if they're tough and scrappy, your enemies like to think that inside you there's this vulnerable little person. There's no vulnerable little person inside me. I am what I appear to be. Perhaps inside I'm even worse than I appear to be. But there's no vulnerable little person. I like a fight and I like action. I don't want to have a peaceful life.
At the same time, you have very good friends. People say a lot of things about you, but one thing that everybody says about you is how generous you
are. Yeah, I knew you were going to bring that one up.
So,
I'd say even my generosity is a selfish act, because I've read that it makes your hippocampus light up. And when I give things away or pay for things, I can feel my brain lighten up. It's the part of your brain that cocaine makes light up. And I don't do cocaine anymore, so charity is taking the place of it.
So charity is taking the place of cocaine?
It's the same thing. It's a scientific fact. It makes the same bit light up.
Right. We're going to just take a break for advert, and we'll come back to some more details.
Extraordinary People. Proudly sponsored by Amazing Space Loft Conversions. Creating a better space for extraordinary living. Extraordinary People. Proudly sponsored by Amazing Space Loft Conversions. Creating a better space for extraordinary living.
With me is Julie Burchill, the writer and columnist. So, going back to being very honest on the one hand and perhaps dishonest on the other hand, or maybe not dishonest.
Crafty.
Do you want to give me an example of being particularly crafty?
Well, I guess pretending that I was a punk to get the job at the NME. I guess that's the only time I've been crafty. I've been very slapdash at certain parts of my career. When I was taking loads of drugs, I was very, I'd use the word unprofessional, and that's a shame because I do think of myself as being a professional, don't miss deadlines. But when I was taking loads of drugs, my grasp on veracity became somewhat flimsy. And the most awful period was when I libeled George Galloway twice for the same incident on two different papers in the space of 1 year. Each paper had to pay him £500,000. So I inadvertently gave George Galloway £1 million, which I'm not pleased with. Do you want me to repeat the libel?
Go on.
OK. Well, I was working for The Guardian and it was a slow week and I thought, I'll write about political scandals because that's always easy, so I won't start with the Profumo affair. And then I said, and only recently, the MP George Galloway stole a pair of knickers from his ex-girlfriend's washing line. And it wasn't him.
Who was he?
It was another Labour MP called Ron Smith. And George Galloway sued us for £500,000.
That was The Guardian. Obviously.
Shortly afterwards, I left The Guardian to go to The Times. And I'm terribly afraid something awful happened. I was taking loads of drugs. It was a slow week, and I thought I'd do political scandals. And I wrote it again. I wrote again at George Galloway.
Without realising.
I wrote again. I was off my head. There's no other phrase for it. And I wrote again that he'd stolen a pair of knickers. And he sued us again for £500,000.
And won.
I'd only been at the Times for a month. Editor was very cross with me when he found out it happened just 6 months before. So then I realised at one point the Times paid me to go away. They originally signed me on for 3 years like a footballer for, I think, £500,000. And they paid me... for £300,000, and they paid me a third of that to stop writing for them.
Delicious.
That's when my career went into the wilderness.
Right.
Luckily, I didn't care. I was taking too much drugs.
You are really thick-skinned anyway, aren't you?
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of people say, a lot of performers, a lot of artists, a lot of writers say that they are thick-skinned or they don't care about reviews. But I have a feeling that you really and truly are thick-skinned, and in fact, you probably quite like it when people get upset or offended.
I was born without the sensitivity gene, and I'm extraordinarily thick-skinned. If anything, I will court verbal abuse. That makes me sound really weird, and I am a little weird, but I do enjoy a scrap. I do enjoy the rough and tumble of abuse, and... probably best leave it there.
But I'll tell you what I think. I think you're first first of all, a performer and then a writer. And I think a lot of people get, when people get upset by your writing, I often think, but hang on, it's funny. She's funny first. And then, not that I'm disregarding your opinions, but I think for you, your priority is to make people laugh and then express your opinions, even if it's, even if your opinion is at the, the expense of, you know, being funny first, and perhaps not that you don't mean what you say, but your priority is to be entertaining. Is that not right?
I don't think I can separate the two things. I always mean what I say. Life's too short. You get into so many fights about the things you believe in, it would be crazy to get into fights about things you didn't believe in. But I do have a great impulse to make people laugh. It's a form of exercising power over people, I guess. And I guess I cannot disentangle the impulses to entertain and to offend. They're,
right.
They're almost one in me, which is quite unusual.
I mean, I've experienced it myself. You're studying Hebrew, and I'm your Hebrew teacher, and you wrote a book about your relationship, perhaps, with Israel and the Jewish people. And we've never actually had a one-to-one teacher and pupil meeting, so shall we have a quick one now? And let me know what... I'll tell you now what I think, which relates to your being entertaining. I often give homework to the class, and I always say, do not open the dictionary. Do not use new words that you haven't studied, because I want you to consolidate and use your vocabulary that you already have. You can't do that. You come to the class with an original and funny piece of writing in Hebrew, which is fantastic, but you have to look up words and new phrases in the dictionary, because your priority is to make us laugh,
yeah,
which you do. The class is very dull when you don't turn up.
Thank you.
But it is, you know, it is, I think, your priority to be funny.
I do like to show off. I guess that, you know, there's no, you can't really dignify it. And I love to make people laugh. And I don't just want to say time and time again, I love cats and dogs, which is, of course, you know, my most used Hebrew phrase. So, yeah, I do look up the odd words to make people laugh. But I do try to stick to what you tell me, because you are such a great teacher.
Oh, thank you.
A very patient one.
And talking about religion, let's talk a little bit about religion. I mean, in your time, you've... you tried to be a Christian, a Lutheran, and then perhaps thinking about becoming Jewish, and then a Christian Zionist. Are you attracted to religion, or is it...
Very much so.
You are.
My line about it, which is a flip on the usual virtue signaling thing people say, is, I'm not spiritual, but I am religious. Most people say, I'm spiritual, but I'm not religious. I'm very attracted to the form of religion, and was in church just this Sunday. I do consider myself a Christian, but here's the thing. I don't believe Jesus was the Son of God, and I believe there's only one God, and that's the Lord of the Jews. So when I'm in church, I will happily sing the word God, but when it comes to Jesus, I just mouth the word. And as for the Holy Ghost, don't get me started. I find it really annoying. So in church, it's almost like some sort of musical quiz game, because I'll sing some words, but I won't sing the other ones. And when they say three in one, which is in one of the hymns, it makes me think of a supermarket offer, like buy one, get one for free. So it's funny going to church. I do believe in the Jewish God, but my conversion to Judaism was so disastrous. And my line is, I would rather be a bad Christian than a bad Jew.
Right. Right. Okay. And the other thing that you've consistently described yourself as is a militant feminist.
Yeah.
Well, tell me a little bit about that. What does it mean to be a militant feminist?
I guess it's an extension of not caring what people think of you. So many women in the West aren't limited by the awful rules and regulations that limit women in other parts of the world. They're limited by their own doubt, their own self-loathing. Caring what people say about them, I think, is the biggest thing that holds women back from being what they could be. And if I was a wicked fairy at a baby's christening, that's the gift I would give it, not to care what people think of you.
Okay.
If you have that, you've got such a head start in life.
We can't not mention your voice, Julie, because, you know, you're a strong woman with very strong opinions. You're very vocal, very outspoken. when I read your stuff is one voice that I can hear in my my head, and then people meet you and you have this tiny little sweet voice.
I can't help it. I've always distrusted people who change their accents. Janet Street Porter once said to change your accent was like putting a crocheted shepherdess on a toilet roll. And I totally believe that. And also, I have to be honest, I really like my voice. I know it's cute and I do play up to it. How would you expect me to speak when you read my writing?
Oh, you know, firm and authoritative.
I like being a paradox. And I know that people are shocked by my voice. And I guess if I tried to, I could have taken elocution lessons or deepened it, but why bother? Because I do like being where I am.
It is you, and that's who you are. Very quickly, before we end, what are your plans for the future?
To carry on as I am, to the chance to be a newspaper columnist again, which was always my dream job. I've somehow got back just before my 60th birthday. I want to be involved more in philanthropy. I want to do well at Modern Hebrew. I want to go out to lunch. And I want to be spiteful. Just do the things I've always liked doing.
And you're co-writing a musical, is that right?
I'm co-writing a musical. And I'm hoping it will be completed this summer. And then we'll have to see about selling it. But that's what I'm very much looking forward to that.
Right. Julie, it's been an absolute pleasure.
It's always a pleasure.
Extraordinary People. Proudly sponsored by Amazing Space Loft Conversions. Creating a better space for extraordinary living. Goodbye.